All right, okay, so let's get started. My name is Kevin Hillman, this is Patrick Tiziano. We're part of Bay Libra, and we're going to talk about this thing we call Lab in a Box. So first, a little quick free advertising. We're Bay Libra, we're a small embedded Linux shop doing all sorts of stuff for hardware and software on embedded Linux products. A bunch of upstream Linux kernel work as well. And more relevant to this talk, we've done a lot of work for the kernelci.org project, which for those of you who are hitting all the CI and testing talks, you probably have heard a fair amount about that already. So I'll do a little bit of talk on that as well, just the intro. So this is the Lab in a Box. The short, if you wanted to stay for 5 minutes and go see somebody else's talk, the short version is, it's a PC with a bunch of embedded boards shoved inside the running Lava. That's the Lab in a Box. So that's the TLDR. But the talk is, we're gonna go inside and see a little bit about the hardware and about the software, how we put it all together in scopes. So kernelci.org is the project that basically focused on kernel testing. It's about three years old or something now. Focused primarily on upstream Linux kernel testing. And it's heavily leveraging Lava. So the main idea behind kernelci.org is that the labs and boards are distributed all over the place, and the kernel is tested on all sorts of different platforms. So as of yesterday, I think we looked at these stats. We've done over 3 million boots of the kernel on over 250 unique boards, three different architectures, and we're averaging over 2,500 boots every day, or 2,700 boots per day now, actually. So the kernel's booting on lots of different hardware, and we're detecting, we're catching all sorts of little things. And notice this isn't testing. This is just boot to a shell and a RAM disk, and you pass. And you know, Linux Next and things like that don't do that reliably on lots of different hardware. So that's kind of where kernelci was born out of this idea. We have lots of hardware that runs Linux, but not a lot of it's breaking often and not getting tested often. So that's kind of where the project came from. So the kernelci.org is a website where some of this is reported. We also do some mailing lists of reports. The target audience for this has primarily been kernel maintainers and kernel developers who care about certain subsystems and certain platforms that break. They want to know quickly when things break. So just a quick thing where we've come from. I mean, when we first started, we weren't even building the kernel on a lot of different dev configs that are in the kernel. And over the last several cycles, we got to the point where we're pretty reliably building the kernel without failures. And boots are getting pretty stable, at least on stable and kind of mainline, but Linux Next is still kind of the Wild West. It's not booting a lot in Linux Next. We just need more eyes looking at those regressions and stuff. Anyway, that's just a little bit about kernel CI. And so I wanted to talk about kernel CI just because of how this kind of Lab in a Box will fit inside the kernel CI type of CI loop. So this is what kernel CI looks like today. I don't know if those boxes are legible, but basically, laser. So we have Git and Git repos here, centralized build servers, and some testing scripts here. But this is the side where Lava with the Lab in a Box fits in. So the idea in kernel CI is this stuff is kind of centralized in the cloud, build servers, and Lava jobs, and they generate, you know, artifacts, kernels, device trees, RAM disk, root file systems that then are made available for labs to then pull down and test on whatever hardware they have. So in kernel CI, most of these labs over here are running Lava with maybe one Lava master, maybe a few slaves, and a bunch of boards down here. So kernel CI has, I think we're up to 11 or maybe 12 different labs kind of distributed over the planet now. Some labs have two or three boards, some labs have 80 boards. And so the idea for kernel CI is all this stuff is distributed. So, but the Lab in a Box is basically fits in this model. So this, one of the ways that you could use a Lab in a Box is to add a few boards into a PC and have it start contributing to kernel CI. And so that's why I wanted to show this kind of kernel CI piece to see how it kind of easily would fit in there. And then after the boards are booted, Lava kind of collects results and push them to a kernel CI backend, which is just a big database essentially where all the results are collected. And then the kernelci.org web UI is actually just kind of querying the database and presenting the results. So the lab, all the labs report to, again, a centralized backend and a front end that's kind of doing that. So that's the way kernelci.org is working today. And another place that's using kernel CI is recently is the automotive grade Linux part of the Linux Foundation is actually using, is starting to work on their CI initiative, actually being based on Lava and kernel CI. So they've been using Lava for a while. Right now, Bay Libre is actually helping them extend kind of kernel CI to do some of their testing. So their infrastructure is basically following that same type of loop. With Lava Labs, and the idea being the same type of idea where AGL member companies could actually have labs in each of their companies and contribute to a centralized testing infrastructure. And then their goal is also to do a bunch more generic testing and some automotive specific testing and so on. So now to the actual lab in the box.
Thank you, Robert. Okay, so let's now talk about our concept of lab in the box. First, let's talk about our motivations. How did we get there? Well, that was the first motivation. Moving away from this mess, fuzzy, unmaintainable shelves and desks and boards everywhere, wires. It's experimental, so we have to go through that step initially to understand all the mechanics and get more experiments with that. But at some point, we have to go to the next level and provide something that is easily maintainable, scalable, and that can be shared with everyone.
Go back in one of those things where we can comment on.
The one on the left? Yeah.
This is my lab, and this is actually the organized shelf. The one that you can't see that's actually hiding around the corner is much, much less organized. So, yeah. So we're not trying to shame anybody else. Yeah. These are both, this is our office in France, and this is my office. So this is all our stuff. We're not pointing fingers at anybody else.
Yeah. We have also other motivations. We also want to simplify the administration of a lab. Today, we are building labs based on Lava, which is a very nice technology, but it's still difficult to get into it. The ramp-up time is quite difficult. The installation process has been also tedious with Lava V1, with V2 and containers. It was a little bit more easy. We also have to deal with those device types where you have to describe your device, set it up, etc. It's not easy, so we want to simplify that. We also have this issue, so we need, in order to control and to run the test on the devices, we need to have access to the debug console, and so have this serial cable connected to the host. And then come into the picture of having to find which TTY device the board is, when, particularly when you have multiple lines. So also we want to simplify it. Because we think that ultimately the users of a lab shouldn't be aware of the technologies inside the lab. They should just build it and run it. Other motivations, as I explained before already, well, we want to ease the duplication, we want to make it scalable, and we want to, in other words, we want to accelerate the deployment of the CI labs so that we get more and more stuff tested. Okay, so based on those motivations, we have listed those requirements, those main requirements. Requirement number one, integrates everything into a single case. That includes also all the software. So we want all the Lava software, all the kernel CI software, everything in the same place. That includes also all the devices and the tests, the DUTs, all the connectivity, all the wiring, everything. And because we started this work in the context of AGL, we had the requirement to integrate the reference board for AGL. The requirements, we want to keep the cost reasonable as much as possible because this is still an experiment, a first experiment. but we also want, if the cost is reasonable, more and more people can make and leave it. We want it to be scalable, reproducible, maintainable, safe. We don't want your cat to remove the break cables and everything. We want the installation to be easy, both in terms of software and hardware. So we would like to provide, we want to provide pre-installed, pre-configured software components, as well as an administration control panel, which is, I think, missing today. We want that to fit in our apartment so that home workers can still do CI, contribute to CI. And last but not least, we want to document all that. Based on those challenges, those requirements, we have identified those two main challenges. Integration, the integration level will be very high. We have a lot of things to put in a single case. How to power control the devices, because they all have different supply voltages. We need to have all the network connections done, USB also, serial cable. So we know that in terms of integration, this is something tricky. That's why we ended up having shelves and desks. And also we want this to be maintainable. It's not because we managed to build your lab that we cannot change the board, add a new board, remove a board. I mean, if everything, every time you need to install a new board or change one, you don't have to spend a day and break the whole lab. So here it is. This is our other box. It's a simple PC tower that fits everything. And if we unbox it a little bit, this is how it looks. So we have selected components. I think the best, there was a lot of work done on selecting the components, and I'm going to describe you one by one the main components we have used and why. So first, a motherboard. So Lava is still requiring quite a lot of processing and memory. So our first idea was to use one of the cheap development boards we have based on our processors. But actually, considering the RAM usage and the necessity to have a pretty large storage, particularly for getting AGA artifacts, that was limiting the use of these boards because it's only 2 gigs of RAM, eventually 3. We wanted to have a SSD connected to store all the built artifacts, so the choice was pretty limited, and we prefer to stick with a cheap PC solution. So we selected Mini ITX Intel board. It's still a quad core running 2 gigs or more CPU speed. We have 8 gigs of RAM and SSD of 120 gigabytes. We use the regular ATX power supply, and what is interesting here is that this power supply is also powering all the devices on the test. It's been quite known in the community that the ATX power units are the cheapest and more powerful power units we can buy. For $50 or more, you have 600 or 700 watts. Super regulated, protected, and everything. If you buy it, if you ever wanted to buy the same as a lab equipment, you could maybe multiply by 10 the price or more. So the good thing is that it provides many power rails, plus 5 volt, plus 12 volts, and that is covering most of the boards we are using today. So that is great. So that's why we have a single power unit for everything. Also, you may know that we need to reset or power cycle the device on the test. So for doing that, we have used our internal homemade power measurement and power control solution called ACME. So it's a cake for the BeagleBone Black, and it's using power control and measurement probes. We'll see a close-up the next slide. So what is good here, why we have picked up this solution, is because we are also ready to take power measurement. Doing CI is not only about testing features and functionalities. It's potentially so doing power and performance profiling. So using that solution, integrating already our ACME solution means that we are ready for the next level of tests. There's a USB hub, because we need to get for the serial consoles. There's a network switch, that is, because we also connect on a local network all the devices of the test, and Kevin later will describe a little bit more our choice in terms of configuration. But it's a regular network switch. And in terms of device under test in our lab, we have selected the Raspberry Pi 3, the TI Beagle Black, the Google BBB. We have the brand new Le Potato board. It's a IM Logic S905X based new board, which Taylor is maintaining. We have integrated the Dragon board from Qualcomm. We have integrated the Renesas Arc M3 starter kit. This is the reference board for AGR. And as well as the NXP Silverlight IMX6 board. So that makes six devices in the test in a single PC. What is interesting is that the device in the test, we have selected a PC case that has the drive base. So it means that we can just, it's very easy to insert and remove the boards. So here is a more close up on the power control and measurement unit. So you have the BeagleBone Black with the ACME cable, and that's all what we call ACME power probes. There is one per device in the test. So it power switch the power, and as well it's doing power measurements. And everything is controlled from the LADA slave. And now, Kevin, please describe a little bit more about the specifics.
Right, so a little bit more about the hardware. So you saw in there the USB hub. So there's a lot of USB connections here, but the primary one is the USB serial console. So we're using USB serial cables, and in our case, we're using FTDI cables because over experience with lots of boards, we found that some of the lower, there's lots of cheap USB serial cables out there, and they all work at first, and some of them just stop working, and some of them stop working altogether. Some of them you actually have to physically unplug them and replug them, and they start working again. And we just found that the FTDA cables are much, much more reliable. So that's what we're using, all USB cables. Some boards like that Renesas board actually has an onboard FTDI, so it's just a straight up USB cable and it uses the onboard FTDI chip. But most of the others are just USB serial to a USB header on the board. Also USB devices like the Dragon board that's in the Lava box actually is a fast boot device, so you need, there's another USB cable to actually do for Lava to drive that board over fast boot. In the Lava box today, there's not any that require gadget Ethernet, but there's sometimes boards that don't have physical Ethernet that you need to, that where U-boot or the bootloader actually supports gadget Ethernet, so there's sometimes you have another USB cable to do gadget Ethernet, or some boards that don't have that have the bootloader USB mass storage mode where they can show up as a mass storage device, and that's how you put a new kernel or something on, so for the mass storage device. So, point being, there's lots of room for USB, lots of need for USB cables and a USB hub jammed in here. Right now we have an 8 port and it's full, so even with 6 ports, we'd have to get a bigger hub if we wanted to add some more ports. So, and then Patrick mentioned the power a little bit. So some of these devices actually power over USB, which means you have to switch USB power, not just the barrel connector power. And the ACME probes that are in there can switch kind of barrel jack connectors, or they can switch USB plugs as well. So on power, like Patrick said, we're using ATX supply, and that's great for all, because all these boards are either 5 volt or 12 volt. In fact, all my boards too, I think, are all 5 volt or 12 volt. Every once in a while, there's something a little bit strange, but 5 volt and 12 volt covers most of the boards that we've seen. So we're using that, and we're just switching that. We're switching DC directly up with the ACME probes. So there's a couple ways of doing this. I mean, in the Lava box here, we're doing it with an ACME, but there's also a lot of pretty cheap, just simple USB or GPIO controlled relay boxes. I use several of those in my lab along with Acme. So there's there was a board farming BOF yesterday where we talked a little bit about the diversity of solutions available here, but there's some pretty cheap ones that are quite reliable, and then there's some pretty fancy ones too. And then there are standard kind of off the shelf rack mount devices for switching as well. But obviously those aren't gonna fit inside a PC. So we picked Acme partly because we make it so it's easy, we have them, and also because we want to do not just power switching but power management. And then networking, you can see the switch, the small switch shoved in the box there too, for all the networking. So all the devices under test and the Lava dispatcher are kind of on their own separate internal LAN, so they're actually not, they have access to the outside world, but they can talk amongst themselves on the internal LAN, so that kind of helps them keep things isolated. But the Lava box itself does need internet access for, at least for working with kernel CI, because kernel CI can push down jobs. But if you're not wanting to do this on a kernel CI type of project, you can just have this on an open LAN and it will work just fine. So the external interface of the Lava box will connect to your LAN, and then all the devices and tests here are kind of on an internal isolated LAN. So on the software, Lava itself is broken into two pieces. There's a Lava master and a Lava slave, also called a Lava server and a Lava dispatcher. So I think in Lava documentation these terms are mixed together interchangeably, and I would probably do the same. But so on the slave side, Lava slave is where the devices actually are kind of, you can think of them as being physically connected to the slave. So the Lava slave is what manages all the USB serial connections and provides services to the boards over the network. And so, for example, when the device under test boots up, the bootloader might need to do a DHCP or need to TFTP the kernel. It's the Lava dispatcher software that actually provides the DHCP and the TFTP and NFS and all the things. So after the board boots, they might want to mount a root file system over NFS or MVD or something like that. And so the dispatcher software provides all those services for the board. And the Lava dispatcher is also what's managing all the USB serial connections, so it knows directly how to connect to the serial console and send commands to the bootloader and the kernel and so on. So it's where, if you have a bunch of USB serial cables, that's where the UDEV rules get created to basically manage all the serial ports, and so they make sure they come back looking the same every time the thing boots. And then also where, the Lava labs are using Certunet or Conlux or something like that to be the actual managing of the UARTs themselves. So that's also on the Lava dispatcher where those things are all kind of configured and run. It's also where the USB connections are managed, so like the fastboot stuff and the gadget ether and stuff. That's all managed by the Lava dispatcher, the Lava slave, and as well as all the power stuff. So basically all the main stuff to make the board run is all kind of managed by the Lava dispatcher, Lava slave. And the Lava master's job is basically Lava provides a web interface to manage boards where you can kind of take boards offline and online. It provides a web interface for all, it also provides an XML RPC API to do all those things, but it also provides a web interface. But it's where jobs are submitted to the Lava master, so if you want to run a whole bunch of jobs on one particular board, that Lava master is where it decides how to schedule those jobs, and if things are high priority, low priority, and sorts all that out. So it's kind of where the scheduling and priority management is done all on the Lava master side. And kind of confusingly, it's also where you describe the boards. So even though boards are actually physically connected to slaves, you describe them in configuration files that live on the master. And then it's the Lava master that gives those configurations to the Lava slave. So that's one of the things that I find quite confusing about Lava, is all the slave configuration of devices. The slaves manage the devices, but the configuration files for those actually live on the master. But those configuration files are where you define all the things that I was just talking about. So what it's console is and as a power cord is and so on. So Lava has this concept of device type and this concept of device. So device type is like a board, so like a BeagleBone Black. So all BeagleBone Black, if you have multiple BeagleBone Blacks in the lab, they all share the same device type. But each instance of the BeagleBone Black will have a different serial cable, will have a different port on the power switch and so on. So the device is the specific to that instance, so where the specifics, where those board specific things are set up, and then they share a device type. And in Lava, these descriptions are done in the wonderful format of Jinja 2. So if you're not a web developer and do HTML templating or things like that, you may not be familiar with Jinja 2. It's not very easy on the eyes, I find, but these files tend to be kind of small, so like, once you've seen a couple, they're not too difficult, but I find it ugly, personal record. But that's what exists. It does though make it, because it comes out of the world of kind of templating web pages and so on, it also makes it easy to extend. So a device file is actually an extension of a device type, and you can set up hierarchies and override things from common files. So like the BeagleBone Black device type actually inherits a bunch of stuff that's common to all U-Loop devices. And then the BeagleBone device actually inherits the BeagleBone device type and can override things, so we can set up custom things. And all this, so I forgot to mention on the slave too, but on the bottom here I have the links to the Docker containers. So the kernel CI project itself is making Docker containers for the Lava master and the Lava slave as separate containers. So they can be combined or they can be run as separate containers. So there are certainly cases where you want to run a Lava master and a Lava slave on different boxes or on different machines, or perhaps one master and multiple slaves. In the Lava box example, everything's just run on the same PC, obviously, because there's only one PC. But you can, we've containerized it in a way that you can actually put it on separate machines. So on these GitHub links, so github.com/kernelci actually has all the various projects that are related to kernelci, including the Docker projects. I can't see very well, by the way, but if you guys have questions while we're going, don't hesitate. You might have to yell because I do not see hands, but if there are questions, go ahead. We can do it all the way too. So in terms of bringing all the software together, because we're doing all the pieces with Docker containers, we're using Docker Compose, which is just a tool for projects that actually are made up of multiple containers. You may not be able to read that either, but it's basically a compose file that lists the Lava master where its Docker config is, and then a Lava slave where its Docker config is, and a few variables that go with the container and so on. And then the third container actually is a squid proxy. I didn't mention that, but because the Lava devices are actually often going and fetching the same, each board might be booting the same kernel, so it's going to be downloading sometimes the same images. There's a squid proxy actually in here to cache these, so it's not doing. Just saves a little bandwidth and makes it downloads faster if there are multiple boards trying to put the same thing. But that's all contained in the container. Right, so this, the Lava box here is kind of designed just to be an example to show how we kind of constrain the lab down into a small enough component that we could make things simple, make things an example. But obviously, if you can build your own, this is not the only way to do this. This is just an example. And obviously, if you can do it with a PC and everything in the case, you can obviously do it with a PC with a bunch of stuff laying around your case and with your mess of cables, if you prefer.
We do that very well.
We do that pretty well too. Yeah. And you got a big board, you might need a bigger case if you really want to get it in the case, obviously. So yeah, this doesn't depend on any of the underlying hardware, obviously, except the device under tests that have their unique configuration files. But because of the Lava Docker containers, we actually have generalized kind of how you define a board and that can actually generate the Lava configuration files, where you just kind of define a board as where is its UART and where is its power switch, and everything else kind of gets handled by the Lava Docker containers.
Thank you. So, have we achieved all goals? Well, at least the first one, yes. we went from this mess to a nice PC case. So, yeah, the maintenance nightmare is kind of solved. And more seriously, in terms of achievements, yeah, we managed to have a fully functional CI lab and with everything integrated into a single PC case. We have no more wiring or boards laying on the desk, shelves. So it's a case, it's a PC case with the power supply of the PC and with the network and the cable of the PC, and that's it. So it fits well in our apartment. If you are a home worker, you might not, and living in a small apartment, you don't want all this lab to get all your office space. So that's also a shift. We believe it's a good demonstrator. It's very nice to go to conferences like this one, technical showcase, and just demonstrate this. We put all devices under test on drive trays, so it makes it easier to maintain. When we need to change the board or put a new one, it's just a tray that we take. In terms of cost, it's always an important question. We believe the cost is reasonable. The bomb, it's not the cost, it's really the bomb. If you exclude the devices and the tests themselves, it's about €400 buying everything new from Amazon, not searching for the lowest price ever. So we believe it's okay when you fully actually use it, so all the trays are used. This could be reduced, obviously, if you have a spare PC, you don't need a brand new one. So any there's no real hardware specifics, so you could use any PC, any USB hub or network switch or power supply. You just need a powerful enough and with enough RAM and in terms of performances. In terms of software automation, we are partially there. We've done some of the automation, but it's still under work, so we haven't completed it yet, but we are still on track. We know we can do it, and everything has been containerized and it's scalable software. Still, having achieved all those points, we still have found some limitations in our solution. The first one is that it's still pretty tedious to build. It took us quite a lot of time to integrate all that into a single PC case. So it makes it difficult if you think about mass production. It requires some good tinkering skills. You need to solder, you need to drill holes. It's fun if you like that, but it's not fun at all if you want. Everything is pretty packed inside, as you can see. Obviously, there's a constraint on the size of the device and the test. It has to fit in a drive bay, also 3.5 inch or 5.25 inches. The 8 also is a little bit limited between two trays. Well, it's a limitation, but we don't think it's a minor limitation. There's only +5 and +12 volt power supplies. I think I remember only NVIDIA both having requested more than that, because otherwise it's cool. There's a little trick to do is you have to get. Heating. It's not shown on the picture, but if you come to the technical showcase, you'll see that. We have selected a PC case that allows us to put front fans and back fans and top fans, so we can make a storm with it. No problem. It's a good question. Thanks. Heating could have been a problem, so we put large fans, so no problem with it. Yeah, so a thing that is a little bit tricky also is to balance the power consumption of the various devices in the test. If you consider the max power, max current it may consume, it could be 1, 2, or up to 4 or even more amps. So we cannot connect all the devices in the test in a single rail. You have to balance those devices in the test across the available rails. You usually you try to not exceed 4 amps per ATX power rail. Something we believe is that using a larger PC case may not allow us to put much more device in it because of the excessive wiring. And something that is really limiting is that today we don't have standard CI connector that would provide all the necessary connections to a device on the test. So you have to custom wire all of your devices. That's why it makes it pretty tedious. So we haven't solved, it's not a limitation, it's a non-limitation of any lab. It's just that we haven't really solved it. So, what could be also improved? We have selected a regular power supply. Actually, we should have picked a more powerful one. That's actually one advice we have for you if you want to build one, is put a high power ATX unit. It's not because it misses power, but it's because it provides more power rate. Simple as that. So the balancing thing I just described before is easier then. We should try to see how we could integrate larger development boards, particularly in the context of AGL and automotive boards. They tend to use larger development boards. So this is not really addressed here. The administration control panel, you may have noticed that we haven't shown it, because it's not yet there. But the idea behind that is that we don't want lab builders and users to go into slash dev and look for the TTYs and everything to connect everything. We want them just to click some more plug and paste things. So we would like to have a web page that would serve as an administration control panel that would highlight all the available connections, pick up the right device types, and do the job for you.
Right now, the administration control panel is a YAML file.
Exactly. One thing we missed with that solution is that it's still too complex and expensive for one board lab. Some of you may just want to contribute to any CI solution or do CI on your own development board, on your current development. And so actually you just need one board. Or even you may consider some companies that are okay to do CI on their board but don't want to use a competition. So this is too much for one board case. So this is something we need to address. In the documentation, we also haven't shown it to you, so this is not there. What's next? Considering all this, what's next? The lab in the box was our first experimentation of the lab in the box concept. We wanted to validate this concept. I think we did. It's low cost, it's affordable, it's targeting individual or limited groups with only a few codes. Next we want to address other cases. The first one is the one board lab. So we could name it LadderBox Mini. We would like to address the professional grade lab in the box and it could use racks, everything could be mounted in nice racks like we have in the hallway. Because if we pass to scale beyond 10 boards, it's way better. And we also have, we don't have to solder and put all the wires in tiny spaces. One interesting thing to do would be to try to work with board manufacturers and try to define some kind of standard CI connector. That would be so great, because plugging in a new board in a lab would take 5 minutes then, because the connection is standard. It's not impossible, but it has to be done. We haven't addressed the connectivity, the wireless connectivity, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth use cases. That's something we need to tackle. And then we would like to start integrating, now that we have integrated the lab infrastructure, the hardware, the software, we want to work on the tests themselves and integrate standard jobs in our lab and work on the documentation. Yeah, so I think this is it. Thanks a lot for coming. If you have questions, that's the right time to ask, but if it's you also have to see it live. We will be demoing this tonight at the technical showcase, so you can see the you can actually see the lava box running test jobs tonight at the event. So please come.